Viewers, today we are going to discuss some aspects on scheduling and sequencing. This topic is concerned with your course production management, and in this topic today we will discuss some important issues and some rules on scheduling as well as on sequencing. Sequencing and scheduling both are very important for every man in our daily life. Every man makes a list of certain activities which he has to perform or she has to perform. Making a list is very, very easy. For example, I have to do some office work, I have to go to bank, I have to take the cash, I have to drop my daughter, then I have to take some vegetable. So these are the list of activities, and I can make a number of list, but to schedule which activity should be performed when and how we can club the activities so that our total activities can be performed within the period of time. So these all issues we will discuss it today. Basically, scheduling is a technique by which a given set of orders are processed on the available set. What does it mean? That there are number of activities, and these activities are now ordered in a particular way so that we know that which activity should be performed first. This can be used to arrange the resources on the basis of requirement of orders, and also can be used in arranging the orders on the basis of requirement of the resources. And on the basis of requirement, there can be different ways to schedule the activities. Now, these scheduling activities can be categorized on the basis of some demand pattern, that if certain activities are more required, then it should be held first, and the activities which is required least can be held in the last. Similarly, sequencing is also one of the scheduling techniques that deal with the determination of best order for processing a given set of jobs by the available facilities. In our terms, in mechanical engineering, we can say the workstation, in order to achieve the certain objectives. Now, what may be the objectives? They may be the maximization of resources, they may be the minimization of time, they may be the minimization of the tardiness of the jobs. Tardiness means the jobs which can be done in the last, we can minimize the total time for the set of activities. After today's session, you will be able to understand that what are the different basics of the scheduling processes, along with the different scheduling techniques with their application in the industry, means to analyze the different job sequencing rules and different job sequencing techniques. So if we see that scheduling is nothing but a process in which the decision making is involved. This process can be called a time phase plan. Whatever activities we are scheduling, they are having the time phase plans. So there may be the different objectives. For example, high efficiency, low inventories, good customer services, and this can be achieved by a scheduling process. And this is a process of converting a general or outline plan for a project into a time-based graphic presentation, given information on the available resources and the time constraint. There are number of different types of schedules, and there are different ways to represent them. For example, one is your Gantt chart, then milestone chart, progress chart, network chart, earned values, and line of balance. The Gantt chart is the most popular, which is used in the industry. So this is basically a representation of a Gantt chart. It is a simple picture. If we define it, then it is a basically a technique used to describe the progression of a project in the form of a specialized chart. Initially, this chart was used in the application of shipbuilding projects. Now we will come to the second aspect, that is the job sequencing. Job sequencing is a procedure by which the jobs are placed before the machine for their processing. So the sequence of jobs in which they are processed plays a vital role in determining the desired objectives, just like throughput, flow time, system unbalance, etc. There are various sequencing rules which can be used for sequencing the jobs. For example, these sequencing rules are often called as a priority rules, as they are determined on the basis of data required to process the jobs. First we will take the first rule, that is the first come first serve. That means that jobs are processed on the basis of their arrival in the shop floor. The job which is coming first, that will be processed first. So we will take one example, that this is a type of a jobs that is coming A, B, C, D, and these are the time 4, 7, 3, and these are the due dates. So what we will see, that these are the arrival time A, B, C, D. On the basis of that, we will schedule that simply whichever is coming first is processed first. And this is the flow time, means we whatever the processing time plus 4 plus 7, so 11 will be the flow time for job B. Similarly, 11 plus 3 is equal to 14, that will be the flow time for C. Similarly, for D is a flow time is 15. So what we have to see, that the due date should be more than the flow time. If it is less than, this means that job will be delayed. So our question is here, that do all the jobs get done on the time? No. Just see here, job C and job D, these jobs will be delayed. Even B will be delayed. Only the job A will be done before the time, and after that all the jobs will be delayed. The second priority rule is shortest processing time. In short, we will call it SPT, or the shortest operating time, SOT. In this priority rule, jobs are processed according to their processing time, or in other word we can say the job having the least processing requirement is processed first. Again, we take the same example. Here, in the initial example, we have done first come first serve. Here we are doing the shortest operating time. So just see that our D job has the least processing time. So that will be the our schedule, and we will process the D as a first. Then C is the second least. So job C will be processed second, job A will be processed third, and job B will be processed in the last time. So the due date is same. So what is the flow time? Flow time is again the same as calculation. The flow time for D and flow time for the C will be the addition of flow time plus the processing time of the C. So here let us see that which job is getting delayed. Here job A, B are going to be delayed because their due dates are earlier than the flow time. Third rule is the earliest due date. In this, we take the jobs for processing on the basis of their requirement, that is the due date when the job is required. So here we will take the same example, and we have again four jobs which are to be processed in one machine. The due dates are this 5, 10, 6, 4. So 4 is the least due date. So we will take the D as the first job to be processed. Similarly, A is come in second, because it's a second least due date. Similarly C and B. So let us see that which job is getting delayed. Here jobs C and B are getting delayed while job D and A are getting in time. Next priority rule is slack time remaining. The slack time is basically defined within the due date of job minus the processing time remaining. So the job having the least slack time remaining will be processed first. Similarly, next rule is last come first serve. The job which is coming in the last will be served first. According to this sequence rule, the jobs that come later in the shop floor are placed on the top, whereas the previously arrived jobs are shifted towards at the bottom. Now we will take the same example, and the job which is coming in the last will be processed first, then C, then B, then A. Let us see that which job B and A are going to be delayed. Now we will see some of the terminology which is frequently used in the scheduling. First term is the critical ratio. Critical ratio is obtained by subtracting the current time of the job by its due date and further divided by the number of working days remaining. The jobs having the lowest critical ratio is processed first. This again makes the priority rule for the sequencing. Similarly, the random order means any job can be processed at any time. So that is the random order, or whichever is coming, whichever is the desire of the operator will be processed in a random order. Suppose we have A, B, C, D, so either C can be processed or D can be processed. So any job is processed, that is a random order. Second is your queue ratio. Queue ratio is basically obtained by dividing the slack time remaining of the job by the planned remaining queue time. The job having the lower queue ratio are preferred first. Now what is the start time? Start time, it is obtained by subtracting the lead time of the job by its due date. So again, this will be a priority rule. The job having the earliest start time is processed first. Longest processing time, the jobs arrange according to their processing time, and the job having the longest processing time is processed first. Now this is a simple formula for calculating the slack time remaining per operation. That is the STRPO, that is time remaining before the due dates minus the remaining process time divided by the number of remaining operations. And now we will see that what are the different criteria for evaluating the job sequencing rule. There may be average number of jobs in the system, average number of lateness of the job, mean tardiness of the job, or the cost of changeover, similarly the average flow time. Now we will take up another example in which there are four jobs and these are the processing time and these are the due date in minutes. So first we will take the use shortest processing time, in which we have taken and we have calculated the flow time for each job when we have taken the shortest processing time rule. This is basically calculation of average flow time, and we find out that 550 is the minimum average flow time for if we calculate or process the jobs in the order of shortest processing time. Now average lateness of the time, when we calculate, that is the we see that how much is delayed, so it is the 58 minutes. Second, we take the longest processing rule, and the same process is adopted when we take the 350 J2 is a longest processing time. So we process it first, then J4, J1 and J3, and similarly we calculate the flow time. Now the lateness we calculate, we simply minus it from the due date and we calculate the lateness of the product. So total flow time will be the flow time 350 plus 595, and in this way it is coming 275. Similarly, the average flow time will be 2750 divided by 4, because the number of jobs are 4, so the average flow time will be 687.5. And if we come to the compare the due date on the job, it is flow time. From the comparison, it has been found that job J2 and job J4 will be on time, whereas job J1 and job J3 will become late by some amount of time. So the average lateness of time will be calculated on the basis of this one. If we take the table, then just see that it is 350, so the lateness is 0. Similarly, we calculate here and we find out the lateness. So the lateness is 236.25 minutes. Third, we have calculated on the basis of first come first serve. So whichever job is coming first, suppose 1 is coming first, 2 is second, so we have processing the jobs in this order. So these are the processing time and these are the due dates for this one, and these are the flow time we have calculated on the basis of their processing time. So from these analysis we have calculated the total flow time and the average flow time for this. Now if we compare the due date of the job with its flow time, from the comparison you can observe that job J1 and J2 will be on time, whereas job J3 and job J4 will become late by some amount of time. Hence the average lateness will be the 0 plus 0, because two jobs are on time while two jobs will be delayed. So 350 plus 370 and divide by 4, it will give you 181.25. that is the average lateness of the job. Fourth case, we take the longest or the last come first serve. So J4 is coming last, so we will process first. J1 has come first, so it will be processed in the last. So we have calculated the flow time for each job. Similarly, we have calculated the total flow time, that is 245 plus 440 plus that is equal to 2425 minutes, and the average flow time will be divided by 4. If we compare the due dates of the jobs with its flow time, then from the comparison you can observe that job J4 and job J3 will be on time, whereas job J2 and job J1 will become late by some amount of time. So we will see that what is the average lateness, and that is coming as 82.5. Fifth case we take of random sequence, that any job can be processed first. So suppose we take J4 as a first, J1 second, J2 third, and J3 fourth. These are the processing time, these are the due dates, and we have calculated the flow time. Now see from here, this job is completed within time. This job is also completed because due date is more than that of flow time, so it is also completed within due date. While see this job, due date is 780 and the flow time is 815, so this will be delayed. Similarly, the due date is 390 while the flow time is 990, so it is again delayed. Now we will calculate the total flow time, that is 245 plus 465, this comes about 3375 minutes. Hence the average flow time will be divided by 4, and it comes as 843.75. You must be observing that when we are calculating or comparing the due date of the job with its flow time, from this comparison you can observe that job J4 and job J1 will be on time, whereas job J2 and job J3 will become late by some amount of time. Hence, the average lateness is 373.75. If we compare all the 5 cases, then this is a case 1 for the shortest processing time, longest processing time, first come first serve, last come first serve, and final is the random. This is a total flow time, this is the average flow time, and this is the average lateness. You must be observing that the shortest processing time, the case 1, gives you the minimum average lateness per minute. So from this table, SPT has shown the better performance than other job sequencing rule. So similarly, you can calculate the average lateness for the different type of numericals. SPT based sequence will always perform better than other, and it can be also proved mathematically. Now we will come to the Johnson rule that is used for processing or sequencing of n numbers of jobs on 2 resources of machines. Basically, the aim of the Johnson rule is to minimize the total production time and the idle time of the system under the consideration. This is basically a flow chart of the Johnson rule, where we have to list all the jobs and the activity times. Then we will select the job with the shortest time, and this flow diagram will be explained in the steps. Step 1, we will list all the jobs and the time for each work center or the machine. In second step, we will select the job having the shortest activity and the time. In step 3, if the activity selected lies under the first work station or the first work center, this will be scheduled as the first job. If the activity selected lies under the second work station, then it will be scheduled in the last. The selected job then eliminated from the list, and we will repeat this process from 2 to 5 again until all the jobs are scheduled. So we will take one example that these are the different jobs, and for example, if we take the drill, there the time is this one, and the second work station is lathe, where the time is this one. So we will take up this. If we solve this, then initial sequence we get this, for example, A, B, C, D, and if we use the Johnson rule, then we are getting B, E, D, C, A, and we will get this sequence. The work station 1, the B job will be processed first, then the job E, then D, then C and A. Similarly, for work station 2, when the job B is completed, its processing on work center 1, then it is coming on work center 2. Similarly, job E, which is coming second in the work center 1, when it is completed, then it goes to work center 2. So this time is basically the ideal time. Here there is no work. So similarly, the D is processed. So since E takes longer time, so there is no idle time on work state center 2. C is processed. Similarly, if you see this D, C, A, there is no idle time, and therefore this is the best sequencing obtained by using the Johnson rule. Now we will take the example Johnson rule. Suppose we have a job A, B, C, D, and we have a two stages, stage 1 and stage 2. So let us see that how we will use the Johnson rule in sequencing these jobs. First, we will select the jobs within the smallest time in either stage. So just see that this is stage number 1, and this is stage number 2. So the least time is 1, stage 1 of job D. So this will be processed 1. And as per Johnson rule, it says that if it is from the stage 1, then it should be scheduled first. So the job D with the smallest time in the first stage, it will be assigned first. If we take the so the D will be out. Now the remaining jobs are A, B, C. Now see, in this portion, the least is your job A, that is with 1.25 processing time, but it is in the stage 2. So what we have to do, we will schedule it in the last. So job A will be scheduled in the last. Now after that, we have left with two jobs, that is B and C. Just see here, if we take 2 or select B, then the in the stage 2 it is a maximum or the more processing time. If we select stage 2 for C, so we can select here also 2, or we can select 2 here also. So there is a basically a tie in the so there is a tie in 2 stages for different jobs. In this case, place the job with the smallest time in the first stage as early as possible in the unfilled job sequence. So if you see that among B, between B and C, B is the having the least processing time. So what we will do, we will assign the job B for processing, and we will then only C is left. So C will be processed in the third. So this will be our D, B, C, A. This will be our sequencing rule. Now if we go to the service industry, in the service what we have discussed, that is for the manufacturing part, but if we go to the scheduling in the services, then any scheduling service mainly concerned with the selection of service order and the managing of queue of the service request. Scheduling in the service needs following requirement to satisfy in order to be efficient and the exact. First, it should be easy to implement. Second, it should be fair in the approach. If you see that for example, if we take the example of banks or hospital, these are the two examples of the service industry. Similarly, we can take the issue of hospital or hotel management, where one has to schedule the different activities because the customer should not be suffered. So in these two service industries, we have to see that any scheduling policy should be very simple and should come up with the good result. Good result means it should minimize the tardiness of the job, it should minimize the total time of the jobs to be completed. In a hospital industry, the patients are waiting. So one has to schedule the patient, that how the patient should move from OPD to the final checking of the patient. So there should be a particular scheduling sequence or sequencing rule to be followed in the service industry. Now if you see that these are the hospital having the complex scheduling system to handle the complex process and the material requirement. Banks use the cross-trained and the flexible workforce and the part-time workers. Similarly, airlines meets the complex FAA regulations and the union regulations, and they often see that linear programming to develop the optimal schedule. So these are the examples of the basically the service industry where the scheduling is very, very important aspect. For if you take the bank, bank one has to schedule that which officer or which clerk should be posted where, and similarly so that the customer should not be suffered. Similarly, airline, the scheduling of the flights, scheduling of the activities are done so that the flight should be delayed at minimum level. Now we will come to the personal scheduling in the services. What does it mean? That first we will take the scheduling the consecutive days off. That means that the workforce which is working gets the some off days. So one has to schedule that these consecutive days off so that the work should not be suffered. Then scheduling the daily work times. What should be the daily work time so that the total number of work hours should not be more than 8 hours for each worker or each officer. Similarly, scheduling the hourly work times. Then each in each hour, what the work should be done so that the customer should not be suffered. Now we will see that there is a difference between the scheduling in the manufacturing as well as scheduling in the services. In the manufacturing, we schedule the machines and the material flow, while in the services, we schedule the staff. In manufacturing, inventories are required or they are used for the smoothening the demand. Here, inventories are seldom maintained. Why? Because it is a service industry, basically. We are dealing with the customer, and the dealing persons are men or the human being. Where here the materials are processed, so we have to keep the inventory. In manufacturing, machine intensive and the demand may be the smooth. Here the labor intensive and the demand may be variable. What does it mean? That here the scheduling is basically the machine intensive. The scheduling is done in the order of which machine is free and workload on the machine. Here we have to see the workload on the labor or the workforce. Similarly, in the manufacturing, the scheduling is may be bound by the union contract. Same thing in this service sector, the legal issues may constrain the flexible scheduling. In the manufacturing, few social or behavioral issues are there, while in case of service, there are number of social and behavioral issues which are very, very important while considering the scheduling in the service sector. Now, what are the different principles of work center scheduling? That is related with the manufacturing. First, there is a direct equivalence between the work flow and the cash flow. This means that if there is a smooth work flow, then there will be smooth cash flow. If the work flow is hampered, then definitely the cash flow or the profitability of the organization will suffer. The effectiveness of any job shop should be measured by the speed of flow through the shop. That means that if the flow of material or the flow of processing is slow, that means that that job shop is less effective in comparison to the shop which has a more speed of flow. Because if the speed is more or speed is less, that means there is a some difficulty in the scheduling or the sequencing of the jobs. Third principle is that you have to schedule the job just as a string with the process steps back to back. That means that one should not be very very strict for the scheduling the job. You have to take the consideration so that if possible you can also take some jobs, other jobs in the priority, but these two rules should not be compromised. Jobs once started should not be interrupted. That is the most important scheduling job, that one should not stop the job unless and until there is a problem in the machine or some problem in the conveyor belt. Other principle is that the speed of flow is most efficiently achieved by focusing on the bottleneck work centers and the jobs. Now, what is this bottleneck work centers? That means that those work centers which are required by two or more jobs. Means the work center are limited, but they are required by more number of jobs or more number of parts. So the speed of flow is determined by the number of bottleneck work centers. Now the sixth rule is that you have to reschedule for every day. That doesn't mean that you have scheduled for your day and you are not looking after it. Basically it is a reviewing policy. Whatever you have scheduled, you have to review it every day. So reschedule for every day. Then obtain the feedback each day on the jobs that are not completed on the each work center. So there are chances that the jobs may not be completed when you see the situation or the position after the completion of a day. So nothing to be worried. You have to see that which jobs are not completed and what is the reason behind it. So that is the feedback. So you have to obtain the feedback on each day so that the improvement can be made in the scheduling for the next day. Now you have to match the work center input information to the what worker can actually do. The work center input, what is required from the work center, and then what the worker can do. These are the two important things, that the input which can be given to the work center, that can be large, but the worker who is doing or performing on that work center, the capacity or the of that particular human being may be limited. So you have to match them. You have to give the input in such a way so that worker can do his part more efficiently. If you give more input, then it is might be possible that he may not able to do, and it will lead to delay in completing that jobs in that particular work center. Now we will see the next rule. When seeking the improvement in the output for incompatibility between the engineering design and the process execution, you have to see that why there is an incompatibility. You have a design of a particular product, then you have a in front of you process execution. So you have to see that whether this delay in the process execution is because of some fault in the design or engineering design, because there must be compatibility between these two issues. Then we will see the next rule, that is the certainty of standard, routes and jobs, so that so forth is not possible in a job shop, but always work towards achieving. Means there may be a certain quality standards, there may be certain routing problems which will come in your while scheduling the particular process or the paths of the jobs. So it is not possible always that you are including all the standard or you are maintaining all the routings for followed for processing the jobs. But one has to work to achieve it. One has to see that up to how much quality standard can be maintained, how much efficiently, how efficiently the routing problems can be handled. So these two issues, it is in this rule it is said that if you are not achieving, at least try to go near by these rules. Means suppose we are manufacturing a cycle, then the standard should be met, or the routing, if you are meeting the most efficient routing assignment, then it is quite possible that you are going towards a particular standard. Now in this session we have discussed the different scheduling issues. For example, we have discussed what is scheduling. Basically, scheduling is nothing but whatever activities you have listed, you have to see that which activities should be performed when. If you take the example of different activities, just like banks, one has to go to the bank for depositing the money or taking the money, then he has to go to take the vegetable, then third he has to clean his dog, clean his garage, clean his car, or he has to make the phone call to his friend. So these are the number of activities one has to perform. Now there is one way that he or she does make a one phone call, then goes to the bank, then come back, then do cleaning of his car, her car or his car, then goes to the market, take the vegetable, then come back, then do again the work. So this will result into the tardiness of the job, and this will delay that the time is running out. So you have to see that how much and how these activities can be clubbed together so that all the activities can be completed within the stipulated period of time. So this is the important aspect of the scheduling as well as sequencing. The second aspect, we have discussed the different types of scheduling, sequencing, different types of rules. Third, we have discussed that scheduling in the services and the principles of work center scheduling. In the different types of sequencing, we have studied the shortest processing time, longest processing time, first come first serve, last come first serve, and the random order. In this whole scenario, we have found that the shortest processing time is the best one. So the short, it does not mean that others should be ignored. You have to see the situation of the industry and the work centers where you are working. So today we are ending our sessions here, and we will take up the next scheduling aspect in our next lecture. Thank you.